Hey there! Did you just get done with a really compelling horror title? Are you done with nearly all modern-day horror games and are looking for your next one? Maybe you're a bit of an old-school gamer like me who's just looking for a trip down memory lane. Perhaps you just want to go back to your roots and experience the very games that taught you what horror was back in the day. Well, whatever the case may be, we have you covered, gamers. Welcome to another Retro Marvelous video. For today's video, we have for you a carefully crafted list of the best of the very best of the SNES. The genre we're exploring today is horror, of course. Now, I must warn you, the past's take on horror was quite different from what we see today. So, while I can't guarantee the creeps, I urge you to keep an open mind, for these titles will creep up on you when you least expect it. With that said, let's jump right in. Clock Tower, a name you've definitely heard as mentioned time and again in our videos. Clock Tower tells the story of an orphan girl named Jennifer Simpson, who's taken in by the Barrows family to live in their fancy manor called the Clock Tower. When one of the other girls adopted by the family is murdered, Jennifer's story takes a dark turn. You find yourself being followed. On your tail is the Deadly Scissor Man, a sweet little boy with a passion for gore and a big-ass pair of scissors. We've acknowledged it quite a bit, but the kicker here is that this one never made it out of Japan. There were fan translations and all that stuff coming out of the community, but fans today eagerly await its early 2024 scheduled revival on modern consoles. In true survival horror fashion, there were no weapons, and this point-and-click adventure only put you in control of where you hid and when you moved. I remember finding this game so refreshing and feeling like I had excellent taste for playing it too. The thing is, developers hadn't broken a lot of ground in the horror genre, so coming across the game that wasn't just about shooting your way out of hordes of aliens or monsters was pretty cool. Not to mention the commendable health system with its panic mode that influenced how successfully and efficiently you managed to perform in-game tasks. I was hooked for a while and made it a point to play through each of its 9 endings. Watch out for Scissor Man though, the boy will appear at random and try to kill you. King of Demons, Maju. Sadly, this next stroke of genius never made it out of Japan either. As an exclusive run-and-gun title for the Super Nintendo, it told the story of Abel, a loving husband, beloved father, and hunter of monsters. When Abel's close friend, Bayer, betrays him in exchange for supernatural powers and kidnaps his wife and daughter, you must go through hell to save them and defeat a much greater evil after. Fair warning, this is not an easy game. As far as the gameplay goes, it brings a Demon's Crest meets Altered Beast vibe to the table with some tight mechanics. Moreover, if you've been a fan of the Castlevania series, you'll definitely enjoy this one, but this time you'll be enjoying it with a gun. It's got some mean twists and a plot that toys with your head sadistically through its 2D side-scrolling levels. This is a game that delivers most of its horrific elements through its atmospheric environments, in detailed but varied levels. Its panic-inducing difficulty and huge freaking demon worms and bosses will creep up on you when you least expect it. Another World, Out of This World. Lester Nightshaken, or Les as his mates call him, is a physicist working overtime one night when lightning strikes his particle accelerator in a very Barry Allen turn flash fashion. Les finds himself in an unfamiliar world where he must kill or be killed. Within this setting, Another World plays out like a 2D platformer with a rather complex set of controls and some standoffish combat. In addition to the regular offensive and evasive actions we see in games of the sort, Another World added to those with its defensive elements like the force field that defends you from enemy fire. There's a whole world for you to explore, and it's filled with interesting puzzles that demand a trial and error approach. The devs wanted to keep the experience as cinematic as possible, as is apparent from its widely appreciated opening cutscene and the absence of a HUD. There's a world of intricate details that made Another World an out-of-this-world experience. This alien world came with its distinct quirks, and all of its rotoscoped lifelike animations and glory, the level of immersion it's offered was more than enough to give you a taste of the bizarre and hunting. Its sheer eeriness was the key, and it went on to strongly influence titles like Silent Hill. Super Super Castlevania IV. Infamous vampire hunter and a descendant of the Belmont clan, Simon Belmont, returns in Super Castlevania IV, and boy was it all the rage. Set in 1691, this time around, you're on the hunt for Dracula himself, and the game will take you through 11 unforgiving but excellently designed levels. As a side-scrolling platformer, this Konami title didn't feature a save game system, but it did come with a password system. Still though, you're going to want to hold on to your 5 lives, whipping your enemies and stringing around felt far nicer here. I could tell how much the quality of play had improved. Mode 7 graphics had once again managed to make a game look so gorgeously otherworldly for its time, and Konami did it while staying true to their noir style of Castlevania's lore. The colorist, subtle sound effects, and chilling visuals managed to set this game a class apart from all the competition. It didn't feel like something for children. This was a game that would deeply engross even the most hateful players and make them pray that they never find themselves coming face to face with any of the horrors it portrays. Nosferatu. When Kyle's girlfriend has been taken by Nosferatu, or Count Dracula as you might know him, the young man must prove his love and give his all to rescue her. The girlfriend, Aaron, is being held hostage by the Count, who wants both Aaron and Kyle's blood. You play the role of the boyfriend, and sadly, when you get to the castle, Kyle realizes a little too late that the place is riddled with traps and infested with deadly beasts. My favorite thing about it was probably the combat system. If you enjoyed Prince of Persia, you'd probably love Nosferatu too. While the weapons were missing and Kyle relied primarily on his fists for the action, it featured an amazing combo system. If a game has had that while being a cinematic visually, you best believe it'll be one on my list. Once again though, it won't go easy on you. No, this is a game that was known for being, and I quote, frustratingly difficult. Needless to say though, none other before it managed to build atmospheres quite like Nosferatu. It was among the most unique SNES titles and remains to this day an absolute fright. Demon's Crest. Our next one is a game that needs no introduction. With a rather short runtime of just about 4 or 5 hours, Demon's Crest has always held a very dear place in the hearts of many. When 6 magical stones fall from the sky, the red demon Firebrand, who you play as, wastes no time and collects them all. Amid all the chaos that the stones brought with them, however, your arch nemesis Phalanx takes advantage of your injuries and steals all the stones for himself. The world is now overrun by Phalanx, and you've landed up in the demon's realms very own prison. Your goal is to break free and get those stones back after defeating Phalanx. Demon's Crest is excellent at building its immersive world. With just 6 main levels, this was a game that presented you with an interesting blend of RPG, Metroidvania, and platforming. You could finish higher levels and then revisit the earlier ones with cool powers from the later levels, often unlocking new areas, enemies, and objects that are otherwise kept out of your reach. It was pretty complex for its time and presented its ability system very well in particular. The graphics are so macabre, not once in Demon's Crest did I find a level that broke the lore's illusion for me. I was entranced by it and recommend checking it out if you haven't already. Mary Shelley's Frankenstein. Based on the legendary film starring De Niro, Mary Shelley's Frankenstein was quite the unique title. For starters, you control the monster in this one, and your enemies are all humans who see you as nothing but an evil monster. You make your way through the German countryside in 1973 with one simple goal: get revenge on your creator for denying you once he was done with his bizarre experiments. I like this one not just for its wooden stick swinging combat where you knock some heads, or for its puzzles, or for its interesting mechanics, but for how emotionally attached I became to the portrayal of Frankenstein's monster here. It was so astounding to me that they released a horror game where the player had far superior power than the enemy, but the horror this time around wasn't the scary monster, but how sternly the world rejected him, in spite of not having done anything wrong. Also, the way everything looks in this one adds to the experience by placing you in the inhospitable gothic environments that bring it to life. Musha, the classic Japanese tale of horror. Our next SNES title tells the tale of Imoto, this pike-wielding hero who comes to Tengumura village to rest after a long battle in which he was the sole survivor. When Tengumura's mayor informs him of a kidnapped maiden by the name of Shizuka, Imoto accepts her rescue mission as his destiny after surviving the battle. And playing as this hero, you must descend into this traditional Japanese take of a chilling underworld to save her. The gameplay is rather straightforward. It sees our hero take on some demons that represent various phases of the human condition in hell, and you roam around stabbing these monsters, occasionally learning a magic spell here and there to aid you in those nerve-wracking boss battles. Let me just take a second to admire how much of a classic feel this game has to it. It impresses with neat graphics and smooth gameplay. It's a little too smooth at times, perhaps, as it often becomes quite challenging and you find yourself falling into the occasional pit on your way to losing life. Making your way through its dungeons feels pretty cool, though. The horrors that await you in this slimy place never fail to invoke a sense of fear, and they do it while looking, oh, so grotesque. Alien 3, putting you in the shoes of one of the most largely celebrated characters in sci-fi film history. Alien 3 was a run-and-gun side-scroller that was based on the film. Playing as Ellen Ripley once again, you're tasked with various objectives in each of its levels as you explore the Fiorina 161 prison colony. You access these along with level maps through your computer terminals and have an impressive selection of weapons this time to fend off those aliens or facehugger attacks. They even put in the motion tracker. What more could you possibly need for these six action-packed stages? Oh right, the scary bit. With some solid work on the music and sound effects front and neatly handled graphics, Alien 3 manages to breathe the film's sense of cold and creepy metallic-looking horror, even in its plainest gray environments. As if it had already worn the steel, they even made it a more panicky experience by presenting the game in such a way that it takes some getting used to. You're going to want to watch your back and lock the door behind you as you free those prisoners. Zombies Ate My Neighbors. When a mad scientist by the name of Dr. Tung releases his ghastly fresh-out-of-the-oven creations in a nearby suburban area, friendly neighborhood teenagers Julie and Zeke make it their mission to equip themselves with a boatload of wacky weapons and beat some sense into those backyard monsters. You roam around saving your neighbors in their homes, malls, castles, pyramids, and so on. There are a total of 48 stages for you here, and each of these will have you shaking in your seat because of how challenging it gets. The goal is to save thy neighbor, and this is a game that expands even on this simple premise by throwing curveballs like tourists that turn into werewolves come nightfall. The level of difficulty doesn't seem so alarming at first, but keep in mind that this is a game that offers a good amount of resistance when it comes to you succeeding. It's quite funny too. Think of it as a cheesy horror cult classic, and a damn innovative one at that. Lastly, it makes some excellent use of its colors and sprite work to really suck the players into it. You don't want to sleep on the multiplayer mode with this one. Warlock. Warlock is as mesmerizing as it is smooth to play. With detailed gothic environments, a spooky soundtrack, and evil lurking around every corner, this marvelous title brings the 1989 horror movie to life. For the uninitiated, the story goes Warlock, who is the offspring of the devil himself, comes to Earth once every 1,000 years with the goal of gathering 6 powerful gems that can destroy the planet. You play as this druid guy who uses his inherited magic to keep the Warlock from achieving his goal. You use 7 different kinds of spells to serve as your power and gets you out of tight spots. It never failed to impress me that a game from this era featured mechanics for healing, reviving, and reversing time. They did a good job on the way they shaded the game's backgrounds. I mean, look at those tones. The other versions of this game suffered from controls that were slightly on the unresponsive side, and something about them just failed to wow the players, but the Super Nintendo version was its redemption. It makes the players solve some interesting puzzles, and what felt unresponsive on the Genesis and the Mega Drive felt like a more bearable challenge on the SNES. Games from the time didn't capture the essence of the films that they were based on quite as well as Warlock did. Ghoul Patrol. After Zombies Ate My Neighbors, LucasArts decided to bring Zeke and Julie back. The 1994 saw the release of Ghoul Patrol, which essentially was the sequel but had quite a different feel to it. This time around, our protagonists somehow find themselves in a far wackier situation than they did last time. When a horror exhibit roars to life and starts to haunt the city, Zeke and Julie rise up to the challenge and make their way through 5 separate realms in order to save the world from the madness. This one feels more like a shoot 'em up title than the prequel did, only to graphics this time looked far better. It makes you feel like you're living in a horror film from the 80s somehow. In spite of being developed with graphics that have a more cartoonish feel to them, things get a lot more intense than they did in the first game, and believe me, they were already insane in the first one. Don't take my word for it though, play it and you'll feel these walls closing in on you. La Place Noma. Up next, we have a cross between RPG and survival horror that tells its story mostly in the Weathertop Mansion. A part of H.P. Lovecraft's fictional Arkham City depicted to be somewhere in Boston, the horror elements present here are those we'd find in flicks from the 80s or 90s, and the player character whose class and gender you choose is investigating the said mansion along with a larger group because there have been reports of young people going missing around the area. I most appreciated how naturally La Place Noma told its story. This one feels nothing like a cliche and actually develops its plot quite compellingly as you play. When it comes to horror, it is not that hard to botch the storytelling, but this game very dynamically sidesteps the bullshit to keep you hooked in fright. Almost every bit of the mansion can be investigated, giving the whole affair a more open-ended feel. I will say that the combat, character classes, and leveling up here could have been far better with just a little more attention, but nonetheless, La Place Noma prevails as a top 20 SNES horror title. Porky Pig's Haunted Holiday. Porky Pig's Haunted Holiday brings Warner Brothers' infamous cartoon to your Super Nintendo screens and presents you with a goal of navigating Porky's vivid and eerie nightmares and getting him to safety. Through these side-scrolling levels, you'll find yourself swinging, climbing, unlocking doors, and riding bubbles. It's pretty fun as a platformer, and you'll particularly feel that way with every Daffy Duck jump scare. You only have 5 lives, so I'd advise you to navigate through those enemy-riddled levels with care. It's got 6 stages and 3 difficulty settings. I'd say the graphics stand out most in Haunted Holiday. As shocking as it's going to sound, it even has a weather system to be mindful of. It doesn't scream scary in a very obvious way, but 1 hour of playing this one will surely shock the player with how twisted the inside of the titular pig's head can get. Ghost Sweeper Mikami, Jure Ishiwa, Nice Body. Everything about our next marvelous entry for today's list just screams underrated based on the GS Mikami anime and manga. The SNES game was a side-scrolling platformer that had the players playing as Reiko equipped with her magical baton amid some ghoulish chaos. While a lot of anime-based or manga-based game adaptations fail to even deliver an enjoyable experience, let alone one true to lore, this is a game that actually does the source material justice while letting you have a good time. I was quite content with all its melee action, but the shooting upgrades that the game introduces are, in the most positive way, overkill. Moreover, what makes it a challenging horror game is that one hit is all it takes for you to lose any upgrades you picked up. The last level was genius, and that's all I say because I genuinely want you guys to give this one a go. Satisfying controls, solid level designs, and creepy boss fights are something you can expect off of this one. The boss fights actually even feel scarier and more frenetic because of how the game uses contrasting tunes that gradually change to something much darker as you face those final obstacles. Castlevania Dracula X. Castlevania Dracula X takes us once again to medieval Transylvania, in a time long after the evil Count Dracula's defeat at the hands of Simon Belmont. The nocturnal being's reign of terror has long been forgotten. When a couple of misguided and depraved chaps wake Dracula up, the Count wastes no time and goes to work on plotting his revenge against the Belmont clan. You play as Richter Belmont, Simon's descendant, and must rescue your girlfriend and her younger sister who've been kidnapped by Dracula as bait. Since this was essentially a Rondo of Blood remake with some minor tweaking, the graphics and a lot of gameplay elements are similar. It does, however, introduce some new levels and feature multiple endings. A lot of people were of the opinion that this game fell short and didn't quite live up to the Castlevania standard, but I think it's quite amazing as a Metroidvania game on its own. It takes great advantage of those Mode 7 graphics and makes for a horrifying visual treat. Sure, the enemy AI wasn't the best, but it had that classy Castlevania feel to it that a lot of us in the community still miss. High contrast coloring and those grunge environments that you'll spend time in here go a long way to keep you hooked and frightened. Equinox. The NES had the widely appreciated Solstice, and the SNES was home to its sequel, Equinox. You play as Shadax's son Glendahl in this one and must rescue your father. Interesting story there, Shadax has actually been captured by his own apprentice from the previous game and is now being held in prison. Yeah, anyway, you enjoy this one from isometric viewing angles, and it is more action-adventure-centric than its predecessor was. Additionally, there are quite a few interesting puzzles that you must solve here. Equinox is a game that presents an impressive number of dungeons for you to explore, and yes, they're all packed with deadly traps and nearly every imaginable slimy creature that would give even a grown-up the ick. With doubled levels than its predecessor, Equinox isn't just a sequel to the NES title, it's a super sequel for the Super NES. It challenges players with its isometric viewing angle and difficult puzzles, but has plenty more to scare you with. Blackthorn. Keep up, because the story that Blackthorn tells is one that goes on for over two decades. So it started 20 years in the past when Tool's ruler, Thoros, faced a dilemma over which son to place on his throne. In a very modern problems require modern solutions manner, he proceeded to kill himself in front of his two children, leaving each one with a stone, one light and the other dark. These two grow up to form their own warring kingdoms, Androth and Khadrasul. Androth, being the one that got the light stone, is decided isn't plagued by monsters, and Khadrasul is the dark one that keeps plotting against Androth. Now that that's out of the way, we come to the present. Androth's ruler passes the stone to his son Kyle and sends him to Earth so that both survive the Khadra usurper's siege. Then we jump 20 years into the future with a grown-up Kyle running into a wizard on Earth. When he's informed of his past, Kyle must return to Tool and save the Androth people. It's quite cinematic. It might remind you of Flashback, but it is a bit of the slower side as far as the pacing goes. That being said, this is a game that heavily emphasizes the action and delivers compelling atmospheres. The graphics blew other competitors out of the water, and the controls were tighter than most games available at the time. There's plenty that it gives you, but its best quality is the way it paints a picture of a conflict that lasts nearly half a century. Truly haunting stuff. Super Ghouls and Ghosts. Up next, we have the third game from the Ghost and Goblin series. Super Ghouls and Ghosts puts you in the shoes of the prequel's protagonist, Knight Arthur, and tasks you with saving the world from the ghouls and saving Princess Guinevere in the Phantom Zone. In this fight against the evil Emperor Sardius, you can have up to 9 lives based on your chosen difficulty setting and must clear its 8 levels. Speaking of difficulty, the challenge on offer with Super Ghouls and Ghosts is perhaps the most unforgiving you'll find in the 16-bit gaming era. The way its mechanics tick also makes it so that you'll catch yourself raging over, not being able to shoot upwards or downwards. It really made me feel like I wasn't as powerful as my enemy, and not a lot of games do that even today. I can't stress the importance of this quality enough. The overall look and feel it had was far superior in comparison to other games from the time, and you're definitely going to be fighting to survive. Addams Family Values. Based on Addams Family Values, the black comedy film from 93, Ocean Software's game was a Super Famicom release only for the North American and European regions. You play as Uncle Fester here and are out looking for your baby nephew, Pubert E. Adams, who's been abducted. This one is more horror by way of black comedy, but I've found it to be, time and again, one of the best SNES games ever made. On paper, they called this one an action-adventure title, but it did present a decent amount of RPG elements, some combat, intuitive puzzle solving, and lastly, an artistically grim vibe. You enjoy this grim delight from a top-down perspective, and while most games based on the Addams Family lore were platformers, this one was an out-of-the-box idea with an impressively immersive overworld. More than the deadly dungeons, you're going to want to be on the lookout for the babysitter's place, because that's where things get really crazy. Do be mindful of where you're going, though. It's very easy to get lost here. Marvel's Verdict. As today's video comes to an end, I hope I've been able to achieve what I always try to with my retro gaming videos. I hope that I've managed to inspire at least a few of you guys who feel like they've lost touch with their roots. For me, a lot of the games I talk about have been heavily influential titles that I grew up playing, titles that have very gently formed my tastes as a man today. I can't help but grin from ear to ear every time someone even brings just one retro name up. Don't forget the games that taught you how to play, my dear viewers. Don't let the magic die out, and help us keep keep those legendary bits of the past immortal. I'll be looking out for your enthused comments and for users who always bring forth more names that have slipped us by with time. And as always, guys, stay marvelous and keep gaming on.